And now onto our dinosaur of the day, Haestasaurus, which was a request from Morgan via Patreon, specifically our Discord, so thanks. It was a sauropod that lived in the early Cretaceous in what is now England, and the type species is Haestasaurus becklesii. Only the forelimb is known, the humerus, ulna, and radius. Parts of the skin were also preserved. It was the first dinosaur specimen integument found, and it had hexagonal scales that decreased in size, maybe towards the elbow. So they look a lot like skin impressions in other later sauropod finds. Haestasaurus was a sauropod, so it was quadrupedal. It was herbivorous and had a long neck. That's got a complicated history since it was discovered so early on. So Richard Owen named Cetiosaurus in 1841. This is based on sauropod fragments found around England. For a long time, he thought that these fossils were all from large carnivorous marine reptiles and not dinosaurs, and he named four species of Cetiosaurus.
That's pretty far off. From large carnivorous marine reptile to large land-living herbivores?
Yes, but it was early days.
Yeah, that's true. If all you have is a limb, it's hard to tell.
Melville reclassified most of these fossils as Iguanodon, except for four caudal vertebrae and three chevrons that he said were a new species, Cetiosaurus conybeari. In 1850, a large right humerus was found near the site where the Cetiosaurus conybeari vertebrae was found, and Gideon Mantell named it Pilorosaurus conybeari based on the humerus, caudal vertebrae, and chevrons. He found the humerus to be robust and straight, and that there was a medullary cavity, and he said Pilorosaurus was probably a dinosaur, not a marine reptile, so we're getting there.
Didn't take too long.
Well, Owen disagreed, and he instead called the caudal vertebrae and chevron Cetiosaurus brevis and used the name Pilorosaurus conybeari for the humerus. Samuel Beckles collected a block of sandstone in 1852 that was found near Hastings, which had a large forelimb and skin impressions. And Mantell analyzed the forelimb and named it as a second species of Pilorosaurus, Pilorosaurus becklesii, in honor of Beckles, and that's based on the humerus being shorter and more robust. Not much was written about this find, and Richard Owen ignored it.
Apparently Richard Owen wasn't the best person to work with. It's kind of coming up to this discovery.
In a few discoveries.
Yeah.
But anyway, the fossil was part of Beckles' private collection, and then the British Museum of Natural History purchased it in 1891. Richard Lydecker studied the fossils in the 1880s and 1890s, and he said that Pilorosaurus conybeari could be a synonym of Ornithopsis. And he also said that the fossil for Pilorosaurus becklesii could be Cetiosaurus brevis, or referable to Titanosaurus, or could be a new genus. And then he erroneously said that it came from the Isle of Wight instead of East Sussex, where the fossils were found. Then Othniel Charles Marsh named Morrisaurus, which is a sauropod from the late Jurassic Morrison Formation, which is now thought to be a junior synonym to Camarasaurus, and he compared British dinosaur material with North America dinosaur material when he visited England in 1888. In 1889, he said that Pilorosaurus becklesii was referable to Morrisaurus based on similarities in limb proportions, and said that the combination was now Morrisaurus becklesii. Nicholson and Lydecker found that Cetiosaurus brevis, the caudal vertebrae of Pilorosaurus conybeari, and Morrisaurus becklesii were the same, so they named them all Morrisaurus brevis. However, like I said, Morrisaurus is no longer considered to be valid, and the diagnostic characters for it are vague and common to many sauropods. So in 1932, Frederick von Huene found that the caudal vertebrae of Cetiosaurus brevis was part of Megalosauridae, and that the humerus of Pilorosaurus becklesii was different from Pilorosaurus conybeari. They had different proportions. And so he referred to it as genus ? becklesii. And the question mark shows it to be an unknown genus. And it seems that he thought that it was closely related to Camarasaurus. Around 1990, John McIntosh found that Pilorosaurus was a valid brachiosaurid with a few species, such as Pilorosaurus conybeari and Pilorosaurus mckensoni, but he did not consider Pilorosaurus becklesii to be Pilorosaurus, and instead thought that it was Sauropoda incertae sedis, which is an uncertain type of sauropod based on its limb proportions. Those darn limb proportions. Some people thought that this dinosaur was a titanosaur because of the robustness of the forelimb, but not everybody agreed. Several scientists have said that Pilorosaurus becklesii is a distinct taxon, but didn't give it a name because the holotype's pretty incomplete, and it's been hard to establish autapomorphies, which are any kind of distinguishing characteristics. Then in 2015, Paul Upchurch, Philip Mannion, and Michael Taylor found that Pelorosaurus becklesii was different enough from Pelorosaurus conybeari and named it as a new genus, Haestasaurus becklesii. So, came up in 2015.
So it's been around since 1840, but this name has only been around for 4 years.
Yes. The humerus of Haestasaurus is pretty complete and unbroken. The ulna is complete, but was broken and repaired. The radius was mostly complete, but was broken in three places that were repaired.
Jeez.
Yeah. The team in 2015 found 5 autapomorphies, which included having a robust ulna with a slender radius and having 2 small vertical ridges on the humerus. It's unclear where Haestasaurus is phylogenetically. It could be a basal macronarian, the most basal, or it could be a derived titanosaur. The name Haesta is the name of a pre-Roman chieftain. His people settled in the area of Hastings and gave Hastings its name, which is near where the dinosaur was found. And I don't know how prevalent Haestasaurus is in pop culture, but we do mention it in our Top 10 Dinosaurs of 2015 book.
Since that's what was finally given that name.
Yes.
Yeah, that's quite a history with all the Pelorosaurus, Cetiosaurus, and Morosaurus names that it got over the years.
Yep.
Yeah. There's also a pretty big gap there. It kind of follows the popularity of dinosaur paleontology in an interesting way, too. Like a lot going on in the late 1800s, a little bit in the early 1900s, and then that huge dearth of publications from like 1940 to 1990 when it springs back up again.
Yeah, that's true.
All for one sauropod arm.
Worth it. For those of you who listen to our Dinosaur of the Day segment and you like it, please consider becoming a patron. We take new Dinosaur of the Day requests from our patrons and offer a bunch of other perks as well. So check out our page at patreon.com/inodino or click the link on the left.